My name is Dr. Anya Adair, and I teach in the School of English at HKU. In this sample lecture, I'm going to talk about the poetic theme of Carpe Diem, as it has developed over time in English literature. Examining a poetic theme can be a good way of understanding an individual poem. It helps us make sense of what the poet is saying, and it helps us to understand one poem within a longer tradition of poetry. At the same time, it can help us think about big ideas that have kept the attention of humanity across more than a millennium of writing and art. First, let's consider what a theme is. Simply put, this is any major idea that writers return to. These are often ideas or questions that affect all of our lives. Two major broad themes that are often explored by poets are love and death. We see the interest in love from the earliest forms of poetry right through to modern pop music, which remains overwhelmingly about relationships, broken hearts, finding and losing love. And it doesn't take much reading of literature to find examples of writers grappling with living and dying, with mortality, and with what it means to anticipate the death of those we love, and to anticipate our own death. The theme that is our focus here, in many ways, lies at the intersection of these two big ideas. This is the theme of Carpe Diem, or seize the day. The Roman poet Horace lived from 64 BCE to 8 BCE. He died when he was 56. During his life, the Roman Republic was becoming the Roman Empire, so it was a time of great political upheaval. The historical moment of transition from one political and legal structure to another can be a very anxiety-inducing experience, making people worry about what the future will hold. This anxiety may have influenced the origin of what we have come to call the Carpe Diem theme in literature. It is in one of Horace's poems, an ode, that one of the earliest references to Carpe Diem appears. Here, Horace is talking about how quickly time moves. Dum loquimur, he writes, fugerit invidia aetas, carpe diem, quam minimum credula postero. While we speak, envious time is running away from us. Seize the day, trusting little in the future. Horace's lines establish what were to become the central elements in this poetic theme. We are encouraged to live in the moment and not to look to the future. Time is the enemy in this theme. Over the millennia that followed Horace's poem, many, many writers have taken up this idea. In fact, the theme is so popular and consistent that we even have our own modern pop culture version of it. YOLO. Really need a heart, it's how you feel, man, it's really how you feel. Cause the pimpin' nice cold, I just wanna chill. I mean, maybe she won't, then again, maybe she will. I can almost guarantee she know the deal, real new. Now she want a photo, you already know though. You only live once, that's the motto, nigga, YOLO. And we bout it every day, every day, every day. Like we sitting on the bench, but we don't really play. Drake's song, The Motto, that we've just heard a snippet of there, helped the slogan YOLO rise to popularity. In around 2012 to 2013, this was a really common theme. It was all over Twitter and Instagram and Facebook, mostly as a hashtag to excuse dangerous or foolish behaviour or to announce that something exciting was happening. YOLO became such a widely recognised slogan that it spawned lots of memes, like the one on this slide, where the internet's favourite animal, a cat, uses the slogan, "You only live once," and then follows it up with, "Haha, joke, I'm a cat." And since, as the saying is, cats have 9 lives, it doesn't only live once. The Carpe Diem theme here becomes the source of a joke. What's interesting, however, and is well evidenced in the example we just heard of the Drake song, is how prominently women feature in the lyrical use of the Carpe Diem theme. Or at least, how focused the male writers of this song are on sharing their day with a lady. Seizing the day has long had a love, or perhaps more specifically, a love-making component to it. So how do poets use Carpe Diem? Like any theme, Carpe Diem can be used to explore a wide range of ideas. It might help a poet explore and cope with their fear of death through a defiant decision to make the most of life. It might justify, as we saw with YOLO, taking risks and living wildly, or it might become a call to fall in love and make the most of time while still being young. Often, poets using this theme fall into one of three categories. Some of them offer advice. This is often put in terms of advice from someone old, telling young people not to waste their youth. Some poets make entreaties, which means making a request or a plea. Generally, this is made by men to their lady friends and uses Carpe Diem to justify asking the women not to play so hard to get. More generally, the theme might be in terms of just encouragement, perhaps saying something like, "Have fun now, because YOLO." Next, let's focus on how poets have used Carpe Diem in the second way set out here, to talk to women. Robert Herrick was also a poet who lived through a time of political upheaval. He was born in 1591, when Shakespeare was still alive, and lived through until well into the second half of the 17th century. He lived through several changes of monarch, and through a civil war and its aftermath, he saw the dethroning of a king. Like Horace, therefore, his experiences may have suggested to him how unstable life is and how uncertain the future. But Herrick focuses his Carpe Diem ideas on one goal, to convince young women to marry young. The title makes Herrick's intentions very clear. "To the virgins," he writes, "to make much of time." Robert Herrick begins his poem with a classic poetic image, which is also an idea borrowed from classical Latin poetry. "Gather ye rosebuds while ye may." Herrick is not giving gardening advice here. Gathering rosebuds is a metaphor for making the most of time. And just as we must pick flowers before they die, so we should make the most of life's opportunities before it is too late. Old time is still a-flying, and this same flower that blooms today, tomorrow will be dying. The metaphor of the flowers is very deliberate, because a flower is sometimes used as a euphemism to express virginity, and if a young woman loses her flower, as the saying goes, she has lost her virginity. Right from the poem's opening lines, the focus of the poem is pretty clearly a sexual one. Just like in Horace, time is the enemy here. It becomes almost personified. It is swift-moving, a-flying, and causes decay and death. The tomorrow that awaits us all has an ominous ring. The final verse contains the solution to the grim reality the poet has painted. "Be not coy," he writes, "don't be shy, and while ye may, go marry." This is a classic punchline for this kind of poetry. Carpe Diem becomes a rhetorical weapon, used here to convince or coerce women into marriage and relationships with men. The final lines of the poem tell the doom that awaits those who hesitate too long. "You may forever tarry." Tarry means wait, and the forever that Herrick refers to is the terrible eternity of death. Herrick's particular take on Carpe Diem and the vividness of his rosebud's image proved a great inspiration to painters. In the early years of the 20th century, a number of artists, and particularly the Pre-Raphaelite painter John William Waterhouse, returned many times to this theme and to Herrick's lines. There is great attraction in the theme of beauty and youth, overshadowed by the coming darkness of inevitable old age. But Herrick was not the only poet to use carpe diem to woo women. In this poem of Edmund Waller, who was born only 15 years after Herrick, carpe diem is used even more pointedly to make an argument to a woman. Waller is not talking to all women, giving general advice, as Herrick was. Instead, he is talking to just one woman, the woman he wants. To do this, Waller uses a rose as his messenger. So for this whole poem, he isn't talking to the woman directly. Rather, he is explaining to a rose what he wants the rose to pass on to the woman. "Go, lovely rose," he says.
"Go, lovely rose, tell her that wastes her time and me, that now she knows when I resemble her to thee. How sweet and fair she seems to be."
This first verse, which was set to music in the 20th century by Roger Quilter and was sung there very romantically by the bass baritone Bryn Terfel, this first verse sets the scene for the poem. When Waller says resemble, he means when I compare this rose to you. This is a classic opening. He starts very sweetly with praise of the woman's beauty. She is as lovely, as sweet, as fair as the rose. But time is at one's back in this poem too. First, Waller reminds the woman that if the rose had grown up in solitude with no one to admire it, it would have died without ever being praised. The woman here shuns to have her graces spied, which is a lovely poetic phrasing for avoids being looked at. But it is not by accident that the final line of this verse is died, reminding us of the mortality of the flower and of the woman. Small is the worth of beauty from the light retired. In other words, what's the point of being pretty if no one can see you? Waller's request is a direct one. Bid her come forth. Suffer herself, that means allow herself, to be desired, and blush not so to be admired. Edmund Waller's world, it is worth noting, is a man's world. It is centred on the male gaze and takes for granted that all women should make themselves available to be looked at and desired by men. But it is in the final verse that the poem's pointed final turn most brutally sets out the poet's argument. Then, remember he's speaking to the rose, then die, so that the woman can see in your death a foreshadowing of her own death. She will read in the rose the common fate of all things. Time, with all its cruelties, makes the expected appearance in the final lines to remind us that no matter how beautiful the woman is, she has only a little time before, like all things, she will come to dust. At this point, I think we have the hang of the theme. Time is the enemy. All things must pass and die, and it's urgent that we make the most of what time we have. In the Waller and Herrick examples, the theme was used for a particular utilitarian purpose of entreating women. But let's look now at what else poets can do with these universal ideas. We move now from England to America, and from the early modern period to the modern period. Our poet is Robert Frost, who lived in the 20th century, and his treatment of the themes we've been looking at is much broader and much more subtle. Frost has no rhetorical goal here that involves arguing for anyone to change their behaviour. Instead, his focus is on more universal ideas of time and change, which he expresses with a new freshness of language and observation. In this very short and very lovely poem, we are not even asked to seize on the day that we have on earth. Instead, we are invited to reflect on how quickly all that is beautiful and perfect passes away. Here's Robert Frost, reading the poem to you himself.
Nature's first green is gold, her hardest hue to hold. Her early leaves a flower, but only so an hour. Then leaf subsides to leaf, so Eden sank to grief. So dawn goes down to day, nothing gold can stay.
A hue is a colour, and the opening lines of this poem focus our attention on the observation that when leaves and plants are very young, imagine early springtime in the Northern Hemisphere, their colour is often a delicate pale yellow, a colour that quickly darkens into the green of the growing leaf. It is in this sense that nature's early leaf is a flower, beautiful and golden. But of course this first flush of colour lasts only a short time. It is only so an hour. Here, Frost's central conceit is that instead of growing up with positive language from bud into leaf, he casts this as a kind of falling. As the leaf loses the first delicate gold of its opening day, it subsides into being a leaf. The colours slip away from us. This is just how Eden, the biblical paradise of earthly perfection, sank into grief with the fall of man. The gold of those early days was soon lost. The same idea of falling from a momentary perfection of youth that it is impossible to hold on to is expressed in the dawn image. Dawn goes down today. Frost has inverted the usual expected image of dawn rising up into a glorious day. Here, the golden colour of the sky fades down to blue. And so, as the final line records, nothing gold can stay. This conclusion is very different from those we've come to expect. The passage of time for our earlier poets led to a very clear therefore. Therefore you should get married. But here, the poem's meditation widens into a general statement about time and the changeability of all earthly things. Perfection never lasts. Our final poem is also written by an American poet and is also written in the 20th century. This poem, almost insistently, does not read like a traditional poem. It's written in free verse, which means it doesn't need to have any particular rhythm or pattern of symbols, and it doesn't need to rhyme. The main part of this poem consists of three sentences, and each sentence contains an image. In the title, the poet tells us where he is, lying in a hammock at William Duffy's farm. In the first image, he sees something living. Over my head, I see a bronze butterfly, asleep on the black trunk, blowing like a leaf in green shadow. Nothing is happening here, on purpose. We're just asked to experience the image along with the poet. The second sentence contains a sound. Cowbells can be heard following one another into what the poet calls the distances of the afternoon. We get the sense of faint noises drifting away in many directions. And finally, in the third sentence, an image of some very ordinary thing, something to be overlooked or ignored, something that's even flawed and dirty. But as the sunlight hits the droppings of last year's horses, they blaze into gold. We can well imagine how briefly these clods of dung flamed forth with light. But it is evening already, and the poet leans back as the darkness comes. A single bird floats above him. If we came to this poem without knowing about the theme of Carpe Diem, we might miss some of what the poet is expressing here, some of what is contained in these images of life and the sinking sun. But prepared as we are by our examination of poets thinking about time and mortality and what it means to live, we are well prepared to understand the connection between the vivid images of quiet life and the poet's terribly sorrowful final line. I have wasted my life. All of those images, the butterfly that only lives a few days, the bells whose sound disappears immediately and without a trace, and the blaze of golden sunlight on brown dirt that flames up only for a moment, all of these tell of passing time the brevity of life and the certainty of evening and of death. The images subtly but surely remind us of the march of our old enemy, time. Shadow, afternoon, year, evening, darkness. What we are seeing here is a poet realizing that he has not seized his day. He has lived among all this bright and brittle life, so many signs and warnings of passing time, and has, perhaps, only now realized what they mean. With this final image and the exhortation to you all to seize your day, I end this sample lecture. In English at HKU, there are many subjects on poetry, novels, and plays in which you're able to study how, across the globe and across time, writers have tackled the big questions that face us all. We hope to see you in some of these classes in the future. For more information about the courses and curricula at the university, please have a look at the School of English website.